Treating hyperpigmentation can be tricky and expensive, but it doesn't necessarily have to be that way for you. Today, I'm gonna share with you some of my favorite anti-hyperpigmentation products, all for under $30, along with some tips and tricks, so hopefully you can maximize and get the most out of these products. Hi, I'm Dr. Jenny Liu. I'm a board-certified dermatologist in Minneapolis, and welcome to my YouTube channel. On this channel, I love to talk about all things skin and skincare related. So what is hyperpigmentation? Let's start with that. Hyperpigmentation is just a term that we use to describe dark patches or spots on our skin, most commonly on our face. And there can be lots of different causes of hyperpigmentation, most commonly including post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation from acne, eczema, or other causes of inflamed skin. Melasma is another condition that fits under this broad category of hyperpigmentation. And melasma is definitely one of the more challenging and frustrating conditions that we see, because in a way it's not truly curable, and we often see it and get it in our early 20s, 30s, and 40s, predominantly in female patients. Melasma tends to occur in sun-exposed areas on the forehead, cheeks, and upper cutaneous lip. We see this most commonly in women. We think hormones, whether it's hormone related to pregnancy, just regular estrogen hormones that we have floating around in our body, or even birth control pills can all contribute. The cause of melasma is still not quite 100% well understood, but we do know that there's a lot of different components that are at play when it comes to melasma, including genetics, inflammation, ultraviolet radiation is a huge, huge risk factor. Even vascular component that we know can add to melasma, things that can cause heat or generate more heat to our skin, vasodilation is a risk factor. So why does hyperpigmentation happen? Well, the pathogenesis of creating pigment in our skin, which is called melanogenesis, is quite complex. But this is important because it's what gives us our skin color, hair color, eye color, and in a way protects us from ultraviolet radiation exposure. When there is excessive ultraviolet radiation exposure and or inflammation or both, that melanogenesis, that pigment production is increased. And so often when we see hyperpigmentation in association with common things like acne or eczema, what is happening is the inflammation itself is generating lots of different signals that is just basically telling our melanocytes to produce more pigment or transform more pigment to the top layer of our skin. Obviously, hyperpigmentation occurs more commonly in individuals that have a darker skin tone or produce more pigment naturally at baseline. So we tend to think of this in our skin of color population, Fitzpatrick skin type 3 to 6. So the most important thing, first and foremost, when it comes to treating hyperpigmentation is to address any underlying condition. So if you have acne that's not well controlled, then that needs to be addressed. Or if you have eczema that's poorly controlled, then that needs to be treated first. Otherwise, you're going to just continue to produce more inflammation and more spots of hyperpigmentation. Now, when it comes to treating hyperpigmentation, the most important thing is photoprotection. So sunscreen, some protective clothing, hats, and really try to minimize your direct sun exposure, because ultraviolet radiation we know is one of the primary causes in stimulating your melanocytes to produce more pigment. In addition to treating the underlying condition, then we think about looking at products that are going to be helpful at either decreasing the amount of melanin that is being produced or transferred to your epidermis. So that is what I'm going to talk about today. So let's dive into some of the key ingredients that are helpful for treating hyperpigmentation. In general, we look for ingredients that are going to inhibit tyrosinase, which is the enzyme that is the first step in making melanin. We can also look at products that are going to help to increase the skin turnover. And in essence, when you're increasing the turnover, you're shedding the dead skin that have the pigment, and over time will help to remove that discoloration. Lastly, we look at ingredients that are helpful at inhibiting the transfer of melanosomes, which is basically the little vehicles that contains the pigment into the keratinocytes. And niacinamide, for example, is a well-known ingredient that is essentially helpful at inhibiting the melanosome transfer. So ingredients that inhibit tyrosinase, the first step in melanogenesis, includes retinoids, alpha hydroxy acids, azelaic acid, vitamin C, kojic acid, licorice root, Arbutin, which is a derivative of hydroquinone, and of course, hydroquinone. I'm not gonna talk about hydroquinone today because it's no longer available over the counter, and there's controversy even amongst dermatologists on, you know, who likes using it, how often should it be used, and some dermatologists even avoid using it all completely due to some of the potential side effects. So if you guys are interested, feel free to comment below. I'm happy to talk about hydroquinone itself as an ingredient. Niacinamide is another great ingredient for treating hyperpigmentation, and it prevents the transfer of melanin, which essentially can think of as cars that drive the pigment into the keratinocytes. So that's how niacinamide works. Another ingredient that has gained popularity over the years is tranexamic acid. Tranexamic acid is a derivative of amino acid lysine, and it's been used by our OBGYN colleagues for years in treating disorders of excessive heavy periods and menorrhagia. And what we found back in the 80s is that tranexamic acid taking orally can be helpful in treating melasma. So one thing before we get into the products that you will notice is that often in products that are geared towards treating hyperpigmentation, many of these ingredients I've talked about are often formulated together because we know when they are together, the efficacy is better. That's not to say that you can't layer each individual product over each other. However, there is a higher risk of irritation. So let's start with topical retinoids because obviously that is a very well-known one. We use that a lot, not just for hyperpigmentation, but also helps with acne, depending on which retinoid you use, as well as treating some premature aging. So fine lines, wrinkles, skin texture, and tone. So you guys know one of my favorite over-the-counter retinoids that are effective at treating hyperpigmentation as well as acne, if your hyperpigmentation is from your acne, is the La Roche-Posay Adapalene 0.1% gel. This is a great one to use. It will help to, you know, treat clogged pores, so in, you know, blackheads and whiteheads, help to prevent as well as treat acne, and also help with the hyperpigmentation. This is going to be the most effective if you are wanting to select a topical retinoid to treat your acne as well as hyperpigmentation. Over-the-counter retinols are going to be more helpful towards hyperpigmentation, but are not going to be effectively addressing the acne component. So this is what I recommend for individuals who are battling ongoing acne along with acne-associated hyperpigmentation. Another topical retinoid that I recommend that's fairly gentle is the one from CeraVe, their Renewal Resurfacing Retinol. So this one contains their usual ceramide blend along with niacinamide and licorice root extract that's gonna help in addition to the retinol in removing some of this discoloration. And this one, I just in general tend to find CeraVe's products fairly gentle, and this retinol definitely a lot gentler than other ones that I've tried. And if you mostly just have hyperpigmentation, don't have acne, then this would be a better choice for you because it's gonna be better tolerated and not as irritating, so less likely to cause further irritation that may potentially worsen the hyperpigmentation. Another retinol that I don't have on hand but I've used before and recommend is the Neutrogena Rapid Tone Repair Dark Spot Corrector, I believe it is the name. It contains retinol and ascorbyl glucoside, which is a vitamin C derivative that is more stable and can help with hyperpigmentation. Now let's talk about vitamin C. So vitamin C is one of my favorite antioxidants, and it has a lot of different functions, which is why I love it. Helps to fend off free radical formation that's induced by the sun, so really helps to synergize with your sunscreen and improve the photoprotection. Helps with building some collagen, and also helps with hyperpigmentation and skin brightening and evening out your skin tone. If you follow me on Instagram, you know that my all-time favorite is the Skinceuticals E-Ferulic. But obviously that is really, really expensive and not everybody's able to afford it. And obviously you don't have to use that one. Available in drugstores, there are a few. Two I recommend that are over the counter, under 30 bucks, are number one is the CeraVe Vitamin C Serum. So this is a great one that is affordable, but also I think it's great for those with sensitive skin because it's not really irritating at all. It contains 10% pure vitamin C, so 10% L-ascorbic acid, along with ceramides. And it's an emulsion and great like I said, for sensitive skin, because with the L-ascorbic acid, for individuals with sensitive skin, given the way often L-ascorbic acid is formulated in a more liquid acidic form, it can burn for those individuals with sensitive skin. But I haven't had an issue with this. I use this one when my skin is really irritated and sensitive, and personally have not had an issue. So the other vitamin C that I recommend is from Vichy. Their peptide C, or their other vitamin C ampoule, or in a bottle, I should say. This one has great studies behind it, clinical studies showing demonstrating efficacy in improving skin brightness, tone, as well as improving fine lines. In addition to the 10% L-ascorbic acid that is in here, it also contains phytopeptides that help to kind of hydrate and plump the skin, along with hyaluronic acid and Vichy's volcanic water. And this, the way that these are formulated, takes a little getting used to use, but it comes in these ampoules that you actually, glass ampoules that you have to break open. I actually find this formulation fairly ingenious. It comes in these ampoules and then a cap that you use to cap the bottle after it's open. And this cap, along with like a topper on top to seal in the cap, basically minimizes the oxidation, and each ampoule once opened is good for 48 hours. So each set, each box will last you about 30 days. Now, alpha hydroxy acid is another great ingredient. Glycolic acid, lactic acid, as well as mandelic acid have been shown to help with hyperpigmentation by, number one, increasing cellular turnover, but glycolic acid itself is an inhibitor of a tyrosinase, and so is mandelic acid. So these are two that I really recommend. Over the counter, there are various different types of exfoliating products, and how you use it is more of a personal preference, but I recommend just picking one. Use it based on the formulation, minimizing the frequency that you're using it, especially if you're using a topical retinoid already, because that can be really irritating. And again, remember, irritation can lead to worsening of your hyperpigmentation. So a few of my favorite over-the-counter AHA-based products includes the Versed Weekend Glow, their daily brightening solution. So this contains lactic acid, glycolic acid, azelaic acid, as well as kojic acid. And there is a form of vitamin C that's the salt form of vitamin C that I don't think there's a lot of evidence behind it, but nevertheless, you're getting quite a few AHA blends in here. Now, it says that it's a daily brightening solution. I would really use this with caution, especially if you're new to chemical exfoliants and you're using a nightly retinoid already and plus a vitamin C in the morning. So this would be something that I would recommend maybe starting off once or twice a week and gradually build up the tolerance, you know, depending on your skin type and how well you tolerate products. You may be able to use it on a regular basis, but I definitely do not recommend starting off with daily use. Build up your tolerance to it. And for some people, using it a few times a week is enough, and that's all you need. Along the same line, if you are into peels, then another one I recommend is the Urban Skin RX, their Even Tone Home Peel Pad. This contains retinol, lactic acid, and arbutin. So a good combination, and it's 10% lactic acid. This is a gentle, very superficial chemical peel. So this is definitely something you do not want to use on a daily basis, at most once to twice a week. And if you are really sensitive skin and have never done a home peel before, I even recommend if you use a retinoid, stopping your retinoid like 2 to 3 days beforehand before you test this one out. Now, personally, one of my favorite ways of using alpha hydroxy acid based products is to use a treatment overnight. My favorite drugstore AHA treatment that I like is the Naturium, that I recommend is the Naturium Glycolic 10 Gel. This is 10% glycolic acid, and it's a gel formulation that you can apply essentially in place of your retinoid at night. You can follow with your moisturizer. Use this a couple times a week. You're getting that gentle exfoliation, helping with hyperpigmentation. Now, can you use AHAs in the morning? Yes, you can. But like I said, when we are treating hyperpigmentation, more isn't necessarily the key here. It's all about using the right ingredients in the right fashion to treat the discoloration while trying to minimize and keeping irritation at a minimum. Because glycolic acid, you know, retinoids, all of these things can and are known to cause irritation. So that is the last thing we want when it comes to treating hyperpigmentation. So this is a great one that I will use a few times nightly, alternating with my topical retinoid. Another one that I like, especially if you're acne-prone skin and have oily skin and have acne-associated hyperpigmentation, is the Natrium Mandelic Acid 12%. So this is a serum, and again, I would use this kind of like an overnight treatment, if you will. Mandelic acid is another alpha hydroxy acid, but it's a much larger molecule, so it's more gentle. It doesn't penetrate as deeply as glycolic acid. However, it is more lipophilic, so it penetrates the oil glands or has an affinity for the oil glands a little bit better, and so it's great for those who have acne prone skin, oily skin, but also are battling hyperpigmentation. So as you guys can see, it comes in a serum, and I just can just put it on. It's not super runny. You can just put it on a few drops and then apply it, I would say, you know, a few times a week to start, and gradually work yourself up to daily depending on what else you're using. But this is more gentle than glycolic acid, so a good alternative for those who have hyperpigmentation, maybe have more sensitive skin, and also are battling acne and oiliness. Now, azelaic acid is another great ingredient that can help with hyperpigmentation, and as you know, dermatologists, we prescribe it for various things, most commonly for rosacea, and it's very safe to use during pregnancy. It's one of the few products that we can prescribe to treat acne as well as rosacea and hyperpigmentation during pregnancy. Azelaic acid inhibits tyrosinase, but also helps as an anti-inflammatory and antimicrobial effects. So that is how it works in treating rosacea and acne. The two that I have used that I recommend to my patients is the Ordinary. One of them is the Ordinary 10% Azelaic Acid. This is, of course, a very well-known one. It's a thicker cream, but, you know, not very irritating. And you can use this azelaic acid, you can use it twice a day. Another one that I have been really liking is the one from Naturium, the Azelaic Acid 10% Emulsion. And I really like this one because it's got, in addition to 10% azelaic acid, a little bit of niacinamide, allantoin, and oat extract that can be very, very soothing. And it's actually a lighter emulsion compared to the Ordinary. And so, but still very hydrating and not very irritating. So this is another one that I just personally really like because of just the formulation. Now, Arbutin is naturally derived from plants and is considered a derivative of hydroquinone. Essentially is a derivative of hydroquinone. Because it's a derivative, it's not as irritating, but the results also take a little bit longer. And you also don't tend to get that rebound hyperpigmentation that you may get with hydroquinone. Now, there are not a lot of purely Arbutin products on the market. It's actually quite popular in Japanese and Korean brands. But here in the US, the one that I have tried that contains Arbutin predominantly is the one from Good Molecules, their Daily Brightening Serum. This contains, in addition to Arbutin, licorice root that together can help with hyperpigmentation. And you know, it's not as irritating, but again, like I said, when you're starting off using any of these products, obviously it goes slow and increases tolerated, but this is a clear serum. And I recommend when it comes to using these products that are tailored towards hyperpigmentation, like Arbutin or Tranexamic acid, I find that it is more effective to spot treat these areas than to apply it all over, unless you have large areas, surface areas like melasma that are affected. Now let's talk about niacinamide. So niacinamide was the most popular ingredient supposedly of 2020. And I love niacinamide. Studies have shown that it does help with many, various different skin concerns, including, you know, controlling a little bit of the acne, sebum production, helping with some of that yellowing of the skin, the glycation process that we get as we age, helping to stimulate ceramide production, and potentially having anti-aging benefits. However, I do feel that in a way, niacinamide was kind of overly hyped. It does a lot of great things, but doesn't do one particular thing very well. My favorite way of using niacinamide is actually when it's formulated with other products, not as an ingredient itself, Or actually my favorite, the other favorite way is in moisturizers. I think you can derive a lot of benefits of niacinamide when formulated into a moisturizer. Now, having said that, the product that I have used, really the only one that I've used as a serum, is the niacinamide from The Ordinary. They're 10%. Two of my favorite moisturizers that contain niacinamide that I love and recommend are the Tularean Double Repair Facial Moisturizer. And I've talked about this in my previous video of moisturizers for acne-prone skin. This is a great one. It's oil-free, it's lightweight, but yet very moisturizing. It contains niacinamide, La Roche-Posay's famous thermal spring water, niacinamide, and glycerin. So it's very, very hydrating, but doesn't feel thick or heavy. And it's a great one to use under your sunscreen in the morning or in the evening, twice a day. Great for, I see all skin types. Now, if you really, really dry skin, you may find this look not as thick enough in the winter, depending on where you live. But I think this is a great option, even for those with really, really dry skin in the summertime, because, you know, the weather tends to be more humid and hot in the summer. Another one that I absolutely love for those with oily skin is the CeraVe PM Facial Moisturizing Lotion. This contains niacinamide, the ceramides, hyaluronic acid, and this is lightweight, fast absorbing. Again, great to use, even though it says for PM, it's great to use twice daily in the morning under your sunscreen. They also make one that has a sunscreen containing in it. It's called the AM formulation. Again, very similar to La Roche-Posay. Can be used under sunscreen, can be used by most skin types, and for dry skin, I think it's a great option for the summer. Lastly, let's talk about tranexamic acid. This is an ingredient that's slowly gaining popularity when it comes to treating hyperpigmentation and melasma. What we know is that in concentrations of 2-5% seems topically is what has been shown to be efficacious. Over the counter, I've tried a few that I like, and the ones that I recommend is the Naturium Tranexamic Acid 5%. This also contains niacinamide, kojic acid, as well as licorice root that's gonna work synergistically to fight hyperpigmentation. It is a serum that you can put on, and you know, I think you can spot treat with this or use it more diffusely if you have larger areas. And you can use this twice daily. It's a little bit of a thicker serum. And then the other one that I have used that I recommend is the one from Inkey List, the Tranexamic Acid Night Treatment. Even though it says it's night treatment, I do think you can use it twice daily. This contains 2% tranexamic acid, as well as ascorbyl glucoside, so a vitamin C derivative that I mentioned earlier, along with a berry extract that's gonna work together to help improve hyperpigmentation. Now, we cannot talk about treating hyperpigmentation without addressing sunscreen. As I mentioned earlier, all of the ingredients I mentioned earlier, along with my tips, are really useless if you do not wear sunscreen on a regular basis and are pretty strict with putting on the proper amount and reapplying throughout the day. If you are darker skin tone, which most people who suffer from melasma are, or those who deal with hyperpigmentation tend to be darker skin tone, it may benefit you to invest in a tinted sunscreen. The reason why is that in addition to ultraviolet radiation, we now are understanding that visible light plays a role in driving hyperpigmentation, and those with darker skin tones especially. And the only ingredient that is effective at blocking visible light, in addition to antioxidants like vitamin C, is iron oxide. Iron oxide is what gives tint or pigment in a lot of our, you know, tinted sunscreen as well as foundation. So you could invest in, you know, a tinted sunscreen or moisturizer. I find that I don't wear a lot of foundation, and so for me, wearing a tinted sunscreen is what works for me and what makes sense, because that tint will also give a little bit of coverage. And one of the options that I absolutely love that is tinted is the CeraVe Facial Sunscreen Tinted SPF 30 or higher. So this is by far one of my favorites. It is more hydrating and contains ceramides, hyaluronic acid. So for those with oily skin, you may not like it as much, but this is one of the few over-the-counter affordable tinted sunscreens. Another one that I don't have on hand is the Verse Tinted Sunscreen. That one is fairly affordable, and it's got a nice universal tint that most people can use. Aside from tinted sunscreens, just the use of a regular sunscreen is important. There are a few over the counter that I recommend. One is the Aunt Helios Melted Milk from La Roche-Posay. That's SPF 60. This is a great one. I love this for the summer. I use it on my face and body. It is a chemical sunscreen, but it absorbs very nicely. It's non-greasy. If you don't like the stickiness and heaviness of a sunscreen, how it feels on your skin, I would definitely recommend trying this one. It's very lightweight. And honestly, you guys, when it comes to sunscreen, even though I recommend tinted, if you don't like wearing sunscreens and you will only use one kind, by all means, please use that, because that's gonna be better than not using anything at all. And that is gonna help with your hyperpigmentation. Another one that is mineral based only, that is a non-tinted, but blends in fairly nicely and it's great for sensitive skin, is the one from Cetaphil. Their new facial sunscreen, SPF 50. This is water resistant up to 80 minutes. And so great for the summertime. And you can definitely use this under makeup. So for those who have darker skin tone, who want to get that benefit from the iron oxide, but cannot afford a more expensive tinted sunscreen, what I recommend is to put on your sunscreen first and then layer foundation or tinted moisturizer or tinted BB cream, what have you, over this to get that iron oxide or visible light protection. So those are some of my recommendations for treating hyperpigmentation under $30. I hope you found them helpful. I hope you found my tips helpful. If you would like to see more tips on hyperpigmentation, or just maybe even me talking about in office treatments for addressing hyperpigmentation, please comment below and let me know what you want to hear more from me. I would love it if you could give this video a thumbs up and then subscribe to my YouTube channel. And don't forget to follow me on Instagram at derm.talk, as well as TikTok at Dr. Jenny Liu. You can find more information on these topics that I am constantly sharing through my Instagram post, as well as Instagram stories and TikTok videos. Until next time, talk to you guys later.